The Philippine Trade Department and its attached agencies get a 4% budget cut for next year from its 8.6 billion peso budget this year. The proposed funding for the agency slips to nearly 8.3 billion for 2025. Now, some lawmakers question this, worrying about the effect of the budget cut on the local industry. Surigao del Sur Representative Romeo Momo, meanwhile, points out it would be pointless to increase DTI's budget if the agency cannot fully utilize it. During the pandemic, the agency's undisbursed appropriations exceeded 100 million pesos, but it dropped significantly to 3 million last year. The agency now vows to make use of their budget for the rest of the year as well as in the coming year. Philippine Senate President Chis Escudero seeks a meeting with Transport Chief Jaime Bautista to relay concerns about the controversial PUV modernization program. There is no information yet on when that meeting will take place, but a number of lawmakers have called for the suspension of the program amid concerns over its implementation.
Maliwanag sa posisyon ng Senado, hindi kami tutol sa modernisasyon. Ito'y dapat gawin lamang ng tama, maayos at nang may sapat na tulong sa bawat grupo na nag-consolidate, super at operator. Sila'y sumunod sa gobyerno, sumang-ayon sa patakaran ng gobyerno, pero marami pa rin pagkukulang na dapat punuan. Bagay na tatalakayin ko rin kay Secretary Bautista sa lalong madaling panahon.
Jeepney groups Manibela and Piston are now on their second day of protests against the controversial program causing heavy traffic in some areas. In other transport news, starting today, the southbound lane of the Kamuning flyover in Quezon City is once again accessible to motorists. The flyover has been closed for about 3 months to give way to major repairs, resulting in heavy traffic in the area. Philippine reclamation officials again rejecting accusations Manila Bay reclamation projects caused massive flooding in Metro Manila. Senators earlier blamed the projects for the recent flooding in the metro, which affected the Senate premises in Pasay City. However, the Philippine Reclamation Authority asserts they have proof that the project did not cause the floods.
We have a document here, even the senator, the chief of staff of our beloved Senate President Chis Escudero has admitted that all these floods in front of the Senate was mainly caused by the mishandling of the drainage, hindi yung nalinis ang drainage at debris and other factors po, no? And Project NOAA has also cleared the reclamation projects na walang kinalaman ang ang reclamation po.
The PRA adds they are already addressing concerns that reclamation projects negatively affected natural waterways and slowed down the flow of traffic. The Philippine peso touches the 56 to the dollar level for the first time in 4 months. The local currency closed at 56.995 or 955 on Wednesday, and it opened at 56.97 today. Finance Secretary Ralph Recto saying they expect the peso to hit the 55 to the dollar level by next year.
I think we're on track. For this year, it is roughly 56 to 58. In fact, for next year, we're looking at 55 to 58. It seems like the peso is appreciating.
Banco Central tipped to keep policy rates unchanged for the seventh straight meeting when it meets this afternoon. That's on the back of an uptick in inflation and a more upbeat growth in the second quarter. Even the central bank governor himself said last week a rate cut is now a little bit less likely. A turnaround from his consistent telegraphing for an August easing in the past. That remark follows an unexpected pickup in July's inflation print to 4.4% above the government's 2 to 4% target range. Now, there will be two more monetary board meetings after this month, one in October and another in December. Though analysts are also not ruling out the possibility of an off-cycle rate reduction if needed, as floated by the governor himself. Finance Secretary Ralph Recto earlier said he sees about 50 basis points cuts in the key rates this year. Now, the benchmark policy rate currently sits at a 17-year high of 6.5%. The Philippines gets a credit rating upgrade, the first for the Marcos administration. Japan debt watcher R&I raised its rating for the country to a minus with a stable outlook. That's A minus, coming from a triple B plus. It cites the Philippines as macroeconomic stability, high economic growth path, and improvements in the fiscal balance. This as it recognized the Marcos administration's SPPP-based infrastructure push, reducing the fiscal burden on the government. RNI further says it is optimistic about the country's growth in the medium to long term, given the government's efforts to ease regulations, boost private investments. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is set to welcome Singaporean counterpart Tharman Shanmugaratnam, who will arrive in the country today for a three-day state visit. The two leaders are expected to sign various deals, including the recruitment of Filipino healthcare workers, as well as collaboration on energy and climate finance. The Singaporean leader's visit marks his first trip to the Philippines since being elected as the head of state. The two first met during the Philippine president's working visit to Singapore last May. Family and friends of the late Big John Gokongwei gathered to share stories about the tycoon's life and legacy. This report gives us a peek into the biographical film that is A Boy, A Bicycle, and a Legacy.
It was because of this country that
determined, frugal, but generous. These are the words that would describe the late John Gokongwei Jr. by those who were closest to him. Families and friends recalled fond memories in a documentary about Mr. John, or Big John as he is more known, with his towering build and booming voice. The biographical film, A Boy, A Bicycle, and a Legacy, looks back on the late tycoon's life through the eyes of people he worked closely with, including beneficiaries of the Gokongwei Brothers Foundation. JG Summit Holdings Inc. CEO and President Lance Gokongwei, Mr. John's only son, shared how his father's success, despite the lack of a college degree, paved the way for the establishment of the foundation.
Dad always believed that education was the key to nation building. He wanted to give young people without the gift of a college education something he himself never had a chance to benefit from.
Despite being one of the top entrepreneurs during his time, the Gokongwei siblings recounted their father's humble beginnings in business when he used to peddle soap, candles, and textiles using a bicycle. These intimate narratives were tapped by the film's director, Troy Bernardo, as his team focused on telling Gokongwei's story.
The difficult part in this whole process was getting the emotions out of the interviewees. And parang we succeeded in allowing them to express themselves without fear. And because of that, I think that's what makes the film powerful, because they talked from the heart.
The film tells how Mr. John and his brothers dedicated the foundation to educating the next generation of Filipinos. In a surprise move during his 80th birthday, Mr. John gave 50% of his shares in JG Summit to the foundation. Gokongwei Brothers Foundation currently holds the largest share in the conglomerate, with its dividends assuring the foundation's sustainability. Over 1.5 million learners have benefited under GBF's programs through scholarships and institutional endowments as it continues to uphold the Gokongwei legacy of giving equal opportunity for education. Beneficiaries also took part in the film, sharing stories on how GBF was instrumental in their education and careers. Producer and business journalist Lalo Rimando shared the short film was originally planned to be a book, but was decided on by the Gokongwei family to tell Mr. John's story in another medium, to inspire not only the youth or those involved in business, but in hopes to encourage more people to be part in nation building.
The family was very concerned about, you know, telling the story of Mr. John and reaching as many audiences as possible. The film is meant to target the widest possible audience. And the way to do that is to tug at the heart. So to make it very emotional and engaging and inspiring. Even if you're not in business, even if you're a family member, even if you're a recipient of, you're a student, you're a teacher, etc. So it's also meant to inspire you to look at yourself and maybe ask, am I also giving back to society?
The film is streaming on YouTube, and a biographical book and podcast on Mr. John's life and business legacy are expected to follow. The Tri-Platform memoir hopes to honor and remember the numerous ways Mr. John touched lives as a businessman, a family man, and a philanthropist.